So, as you can see from here, there are now two lectures, today and tomorrow, which are maybe the core of the course. And where I want to show how the chiral anomaly is defined on the lattice, and in particular, how once you have properly defined the chiral anomaly, you can arrive to the so-called Witten-Veneziano formula or mechanism that was proposed in 78 by Witten and then by Veneziano. And it took almost 30 years to make it concrete. So the goal of these two lectures is to explain why this number is much larger than those numbers here, okay? And why is interesting, especially for a tool like Lattice, is interesting because okay, the anomaly. What is the anomaly? The anomaly is the breaking of a symmetry which you have at the classical level, which is broken by the quantization. Okay, when you quantize the theory, the quantization, it's not compatible with this symmetry, and therefore you break the symmetry. And in this quantity here, the anomaly gives a non-perturbative computation, a non-perturbative term, sorry, contribution. So this means that if you test this mass here and you reproduce the experimental value, you have tested the anomaly, the anomaly, a non-perturbative contribution due to the anomaly in QCD. Okay, so this is a non-perturbative test of the breaking of a classical symmetry at the quantum level. This is why it's so interesting, because it puts together everything we would like to test about QCD. And this is why our community spent almost 30 years to try to do this. Okay. And it's still not finished. So the point, so today we will be focusing on the axial symmetry, on the singlet left-right symmetry, which breaks down to the baryon group, the U1 baryon group. So it's the breaking on the U1 axial generator here. So this, now we will go into detail. The combination of these two groups here, the axial combination is broken by the anomaly, okay, and then the symmetry is broken to the vector subgroup of this bigger group. Okay. So yesterday we saw that one way to avoid the problem of doublets is to define the the Wilson action for the fermions. I just repeat it because at some point we will need it. So the Wilson action for fermions is a to the fourth sum over x, psi of x. And then there is the Wilson operator plus the mass times psi over x, psi, yes, over x. Let's forget about it. Psi, sorry, psi over x, psi over x. Okay. Where the Wilson operator is 1/2 gamma mu d mu star plus d mu minus d mu star d mu, where these are the forward and the backward derivative. Yesterday we saw them in the free case. Now, if you want to make all these gauge invariant, what you have to do is just to modify, for instance, the forward derivative. You put a link, and then, like you do for the covariant derivative in the continuum, and this is x plus mu minus psi of x. So you see, this links takes the field in x plus mu and move it to x so that this has an easy gauge transformation. D mu psi, in this case, is psi of x minus u mu dagger of x minus mu. Okay. Now, what we discussed yesterday, and then you can write it in the Fourier basis and so on for the free case. What we discussed, so this part here would preserve chiral symmetry, okay? But this term here is like a mass term, okay? It's just diagonal in the Dirac basis, and it doesn't preserve chiral symmetry. There is another property that is like in the continuum. Sometimes we will use it. Now you can see, now as I said at the beginning, the on the lattice, we don't have any more really a functional integral. What we have on the lattice is actually a standard integral, okay, on the group manifold of the links, and D, it is just a matrix, okay, just a matrix, and the index of this matrix is color, spin, and space-time, okay? So if you have a volume V, if you have a volume V, which is L naught times L cube, okay, points, then in the case of SU3 color, the number of indices that you have for this matrix is L naught times L cube times 4 times 2, times 3, okay? So this is just a 12 volumes, volume times 12 volume matrix. Just keep in mind this. And this matrix here satisfies the so-called gamma 5 hermeticity, like this, okay? Like the operator in the continuum. If you put a gamma 5, it commutes with gamma mu. The derivative is anti-Hermitian operator, but then if you do like this, if instead of doing the Hermitian, you do the gamma phi hermeticity, it is satisfied also like in the continuum. Okay, now, the problem of the Wilson action is that, again, there is this term here, and this term makes a disaster in all the argumentation. One particular case where you can see the disaster is that you are used in QCD to have a logarithmic ultraviolet divergence for the quark mass. So the quark mass, they teach you that you just multiply by the renormalization constant of the quark mass, which is logarithmically divergent in the cutoff, okay? But this is true because you have exact chiral symmetry, for instance, in dimensional regularization. But if you have an explicit breaking of chiral symmetry, this is not true anymore. For instance, the quark mass in this case has an additive power with 1 over A, so power 1, divergent renormalization. Okay, so this term here, we still use a lot this term, we'll still use a lot this action, but this term here makes everything much more complicated than if you have exact chiral symmetry, okay? And of course, the problem of the eta prime is already so complicated that if you use something that is so difficult to manage, okay, we never arrive to a solution in this way, okay, over 30 years. But okay, the big change happened in 98, and actually the milestone of this story starts already in 82. So I write here just the milestone, and then I tell you which of those points we will go through. And we cannot do everything. So there is a paper by Gisbard and Wilson, which is of 82. Gisbard is the same of the archive. Okay. Then the other milestone is Kaplan, that we'll teach here next week, David Kaplan. And this is 92, with the introduction of the so-called domain Wolf fermions. And then there is Neuberger on 97. And at the same time, there is Peter Asenfratz, 98. Okay, and then there is Luscher, 98, and Hernandez et al., Janssen and Luscher on 99. Okay, so these are the milestones. Okay, here the Gisbard-Wilson relation was introduced by Gisbard and Wilson, but then there was the Gisbard-Wilson relation is a relation, which I write immediately, so you know what I'm talking about. It's a relation made like this. It says that, okay, the Nielsen-Inomiya theorem says that our four hypotheses are incompatible. But then Gisbard and Wilson proposed that D is, as usual, gamma mu, in the continuum will be gamma mu d mu, okay? So it's just the operator which enter here, okay? And they say that what they call the minimal breaking of chiral symmetry, whatever it means, would be An operator would be an operator D that satisfies this relation here, where A bar is just the lattice spacing divided. S is a real parameter from 0 to 1. So if you don't like A bar, just put A, the lattice spacing, and put S equal 1. It's a solution okay, you see, so they replace, instead of the anti-commutator of gamma phi with D, it's the anti-commutator of gamma phi with D is equal to this other term here. Now we will see why it could make sense. So this was done by Gisbert and Wilson in 82. But then there was no solution to that relation, and this relation was completely forgotten. Okay. Then there was Kaplan in 92 that proposed the so-called domain wall fermion. We will not discuss this. Maybe David will do next week in the effective theory framework. But then here in 92 was not realized that this solution here was related to Gisbert-Wilson at all. I mean, this paper was completely forgotten. And it was Neuberger and Asenfratz that they realized that not only these fermions and also another kind of fermions here proposed by Asenfratz satisfy the Gisbert-Wilson relation, but also Neuberger was able to start from this five-dimensional construction to extract the effective four-dimensional action. And this action was proven to satisfy the Gisbert-Wilson relation. Okay? So the history is a bit, so here was found essentially the solution to this, but was not recognized, and it was recognized here and cleaned up. Okay? But then at this point was still not clear whether there was a chiral symmetry or not on the lattice, and the chiral symmetry was proposed by Luschner a year later. And then here, okay, the solution was proven to be local. We will see what it means just 1 year later. And I would say that here it ends, okay, the revolution of the Gisbert-Wilson fermions on the lattice. Then there were many, many papers, but I mean, these are the main milestones. Okay, before we are a bit more rigorous, maybe you can forget this argument, okay? But I just want to give you why this could be an interesting, why this could lead to exact chiral symmetry on the lattice. Now, yesterday we saw that there is the path integral, and e to the minus gluon part minus this fermion part, okay? And for instance, these for the moment are Wilson fermions, okay? Now, if you do this in the Grassmann integral here, this Grassmann integral is just quadratic, so we can do this, will give you the determinant, okay, will give the gluon action times the determinant of the Dirac operator times, okay, here. Sorry, let's put here some operator. For instance, let's put here u bar gamma 5d in some point. Sorry, u bar gamma 5d. So this is the quark up, this is the quark down in some point x. And then let's correlate with the d bar in point 0, gamma 5u in 0. Okay? So what I have done here. I just want to compute the correlator or the pseudo scalar with flavor u bar d with the pseudo scalar with flavor u d bar. Okay? Now, if you do this and then you solve for the fermions, what you are left here, it is just the minus the trace of, so there is a minus when you do the weak contraction of the propagator. Now, the propagator of the u quark between x and 0, gamma 5, the propagator of the down quark between 0 and x, gamma 5. Okay? So what I have done here is just the fermion integral. It gives you the determinant times the propagators. Okay? So what Gisbert and Wilson said is that actually every time that we look at something like this, okay, from where we extract the physics? We extract the physics by looking at these correlators and by looking at the correlator when x is different from 0, so at what we used to call at a physical distance. Because when x goes to 0, we know already in the continuum, There are a plethora of short distance singularities which are not physical, okay, and we have to be very careful treating them. But instead, if you go on shell, so at x different from zero, then from there you can extract the physics. And what they notice is that here, what you would really need to have exact chiral symmetry, it is not to have chiral symmetry for the operator, but actually for the inverse would be enough. Of course, if you have for the operator, you have also for the inverse, okay? In this part, yeah, let's leave for the moment the determinant. If you have for the operator, you have also for the inverse. But they say, well, maybe we can have just for the inverse. And now if you take this relation here, I tell this and then you forget it. And you assume that I can invert the Dirac operator, so there are not zero modes, which is not the case in general, okay? But if I assume that, then you multiply by d to the minus 1 and d to the minus 1 here, and then you get d to the minus 1 x 0 gamma 5 plus gamma 5 d to the minus 1 x 0 is equal to a bar gamma 5 delta of x 0. Okay? So the point is that if you have this relation here, you can have exact chiral symmetry for the propagator, for the everywhere except where x is equal to 0. But x equal to 0 is where the contact terms are, where we are not interested, okay? So this is why they put forward this relation, because this would be something that in the region of kinematics, so when x is different from 0, we are interested in, would be equivalent to have exact chiral symmetry for the propagator, okay? So this is the origin of this relation here. There are questions? This is the origin of the idea, okay? Okay, so let's be a bit more precise. And then let's define. And then let's define a matrix which is called gamma 5 at, which is defined like gamma 5 1 minus a bar d. Okay. Now notice that this matrix here is the d. Now it's a full interacted Dirac operator if it exists. If it exists a solution to this, we will see that it exists. So D in particular depends on the gauge field. So here I'm assuming that we have a background gauge field. So gamma 5 at variance with respect to gamma 5, it's a matrix in this 12 times volume dimensional space. It's a matrix which depends on the gauge field. Okay. And now, if you write this matrix, then this relation here can be written like gamma 5d plus d gamma 5 at equal to 0. Okay? So this is very similar to what you have with the standard chiral symmetry, with the exception that now one of the gamma 5 by the gamma 5 at. Okay? This is just one form of writing it. You can put the gamma 5 at here and so on. I mean, there are many ways to do it. They are all equivalent. So once we have this, let's write the fermion action in the massless case on the lattice, and then here we will get sum over x, psi bar of x, d of psi in x. Okay, this is just the matrix fermion action. Then Luschel proposed that actually this action here is invariant under what is called the Luschel symmetry. And the symmetry is the following. Let's take that psi goes in psi prime equal psi, the infinitesimal form, plus 0a gamma 5 at psi. Now this epsilon, now 0 stands for singlet, because later we will need also the non-singlet ones, and a stands for axial. Okay, this is an axial transformation. And psi prime goes in psi prime equal psi prime bar goes in psi bar plus e epsilon 0 a psi bar gamma 5. So the psi, the fermions, we are in the Euclidean, so but the fermions transform with gamma 5 at this modified matrix, while the psi bar transform just in the standard way. So this means that delta okay, here then I can define then delta psi equal psi minus psi prime and is equal to minus I epsilon a gamma 5 at psi, and I can do the same with delta psi bar minus psi bar prime. Then if I do that and I compute the variation of the action with respect to this transformation, what I get is that the action is minus a to the fourth I epsilon a zero sum over x of psi bar x, and then I get gamma 5 d plus gamma 5 at on psi all in x. Okay, and now if my operator d satisfies the Gisbert-Wilson relation here, then this is equal to zero. Okay, so if I have a fermion operator which satisfies the Gisbert-Wilson relation, I have also the Luscher symmetry, and the Luscher symmetry remember it's just like the standard one axial symmetry with the just the change that here you have this peculiar gamma 5 at, okay, which depends on the background gauge field. So we have learned now that under that rotation, delta S is equal to zero, okay? Now let's see what happened to the measure. As I said, on the lattice, you don't have freedom to change anything, okay? So we have just to do now a change of variable. And now let's take not anymore the infinitesimal form, let's take the full form of it because it's easier to treat. So here let's say that epsilon prime is e to the I epsilon 0 a gamma 5 at psi, and here psi bar prime is equal to psi bar e to the I epsilon 0 a gamma 5. And now what we do, we see how the measure, how the psi prime, the psi, we can write as a function, you know, as a, how the measure change under this change of variable. And this will be d psi bar d psi. And then you have to remember with the Grassmann variables, the determinant of the Jacobian is the, here you get the inverse of it, okay? With Grassmann variables, it's not the Jacobian, it's the inverse of it when you make a change of variables. Then this means that here you get determinant of e to the I epsilon a zero gamma 5. And here you get, this is for the psi bar prime, and here you get determinant of e to the I epsilon 0 a gamma 5 at. Now, as usual, the determinant of the exponent you can write with the trace, with the exponent of the trace. And then this here, then you can write like e, this part here, you can write e to the a 0 trace of gamma 5 at. And then you can do the same for this part here, e to the minus e trace of gamma 5, but trace of gamma 5 is equal to 0. Okay, and therefore e to the 0 is 1. And then this is d psi bar d psi. So you see that under this transformation, now we will see what is this trace. But under this transformation, in principle, in general, the measure is not invariant anymore like before. You see, now this I think make it clear, very clear, what happens when you have naive fermions. When you have naive fermions, you can do exactly the same that I did here, but here you will have a gamma 5, okay? And then here you will have a gamma 5, and like for this case, this will be 0. And so the measure would be invariant, and you would not have any chiral anomaly, okay? And why? Because you have the doublers. One, the real fermion, the anomaly of the fermion you would like to have is eaten by one of the doublers. While in the case of Gisbard-Wilson, this is not the case. Okay. Okay. Questions on this? Now let's define here a to the 4 qx. It will be clear why I call it qx. A bar over 2 trace of gamma 5 d of xx. Now this trace here is the trace on the full matrix, color, spin, and space-time. Now, here is the trace only on the color and on the spin. Okay, you see, I explicitly wrote xx here. Now, if we define the integral of this quantity, which is a to the fourth x, okay, then one can prove that q is equal 1/2 of trace of gamma 5 at, okay? So what happened here, I just call it back, I call it trace of gamma 5 at this point, 2 times q, okay? Now, if you now are very patient and you lose, I think, a couple of days, you can expand this quantity here exactly like we did for the plaquette, okay? So you write all your links. First of all, I will give you a solution of this. And once I give you a solution of this, you do exactly what we did with the plaquette. You write every links like e to the minus a the field. You expand in the lattice spacing. And then in the classical continuum limit, what you would get is 1 over 32 pi square epsilon mu nu rho sigma trace of f mu nu f rho sigma, okay, which is nothing else than what we call ff tilde, okay? So the topological charge density, okay? So this quantity here, if you, again, it's a discretization, so it's written as, it looks like a fermionic operator, but it's not a fermionic operator, it's just written through the Dirac operator, okay? But this is just, if you look like it is, it's just a gluonic operator, and if you expand for a that goes to 0, you recover the topological charge density, okay, a discretization of it, okay? So you see that we are building up here the anomaly, okay? Because now, yes, now what we can do here is so here we can write d psi equal to e to the minus epsilon 0 a. We say that trace of gamma 5 at is 2 times q, so here is a 2 times q, times d psi bar psi, okay? So these two relations are the most important for the following. So the action is symmetric, the theory at the classical level is symmetric under this transformation. But it's the quantization, so if you like the commutation relation in the language you're used, that are incompatible with this symmetry. And this shows up by with the fact that the measure is not anymore invariant. Questions? Okay. So before finding the solution on Neuberger, let's convince ourselves that, you know, I didn't do this expansion, but let's convince ourselves that this is what it is. So, in a cheap way. So now, once we have this definition here, so let's look at the spectral properties of D, okay, for a generic D that satisfies the Gisbert-Wilson relation. Okay, so from the definition of gamma 5 hat, we can say that A times D is equal to 1 minus gamma 5 hat. Okay, now this is left as an exercise. You can prove also that gamma 5, this times the dagger of this operator is equal to 1. So this is a unitary operator, okay? You can also prove that gamma 5 hat is equal to gamma 5 dagger by using the Gisbert-Wilson relation, and gamma 5 square is equal to 1, okay? As the properties of like the ones of gamma 5. But for the moment, we are interested in this. So this is a unitary operator, and then this means, and also what you can prove by using the gamma 5 hermeticity and this relation here, you can also prove that DD dagger commutes. Okay, so this means that this operator is renormalizable. Renormalizable is diagonalizable. so we can diagonalize it. Okay, and the diagonalization is the following. I know the lambda is reversed, but I write like this. So A lambda bar is 1 minus e to the I alpha. So since this is a unitary operator, every eigenvalue of A bar of D has to be equal times A bar has to be equal to 1 minus a phase. Okay. So this means that lambda bar can be equal to 0 if the phase, if this e to the I alpha is equal to 1. Lambda bar can be a complex number. And lambda bar can be 2. Actually, can be 2 over A. Okay? When this number is minus 1, then lambda bar can be 2 over A. Okay, so let's see now, let's now focus on lambda bar equals 0. So, and let's use the Gisbert-Wilson relation. So lambda bar equals 0 means, by using the gamma 5 d plus d gamma 5, times its eigenvector. This quantity here, it's A bar D gamma 5 D of U lambda, okay? But now, since lambda is equal to 0, this is equal, so we can forget this when we apply here, and we can forget it because this one, because D applies on lambda. Then this means that also D gamma 5 U lambda to 0, okay? So in particular, it means then that you have U lambda is an eigenvector with lambda bar equal to 0, and also gamma 5 U lambda is an eigenvector with lambda bar equal to 0, okay? But then this means that either there is only one eigenvector only, or yes, one eigenvector, so that U lambda and gamma 5 U lambda up to a phase, it's the same vector, okay? Or that you can always choose in the subspace of the zero modes a vector u lambda, the vector u lambda, so that they are eigenvectors not only of d but also gamma 5. Okay, you remove the degeneracy with gamma 5. So in general, one can say that for the zero modes, what you have is that gamma 5 is equal plus or minus u lambda. Okay, and what we call n plus or minus, the number of modes with chirality plus and chirality, okay, so this is the number of modes with chirality plus or with chirality minus, okay? So this is telling us that for the zero modes are chiral, and they can be, in general, n plus 0 modes with chirality plus and n minus 0 modes with chirality minus. Okay, now let's move to lambda equal 2, the other simple case here. So let's take here 2 over A bar. And let's do the same exercise. So this means gamma 5 d plus d gamma 5 u lambda is equal to a bar d gamma 5 d u lambda. Okay. And now again, when d applies on u lambda, here you can replace 2 over a bar. Here you can replace again 2 over a bar. Okay. And at the end, what you get, so you see that now you have d gamma 5, and d gamma 5 2 over a bar cancel this here. You bring this d gamma 5 on the other side, the 2 becomes 1. And so this means at the end that here d gamma 5 is equal to 2 over a bar d gamma 5 u lambda is equal to 2 su a bar gamma 5 u lambda. Again, this d gamma this is a d gamma 5 times 2. This is a d gamma 5 times 1. We bring on the other side, becomes a 1. And this is just gamma 5 on u lambda times 2 over a. Okay? So this is telling us that the eigenvectors associated to the eigenvalue, which are 2 over a, again, if there is 1 u lambda with this eigenvalue, there must be also gamma 5 u lambda with the same eigenvalue. And then we do exactly the same argument. And then this means that with lambda 2 over a, we can have gamma u lambda equal plus or minus u lambda. And here we call n prime plus or minus the modes, the number of modes with chirality plus or minus. Okay. Now we are left with, now I leave as an exercise the last option, and the result is the following: is that if for lambda, which belongs to a complex, which is not a generic complex, is a complex written like 1 minus e to the I alpha, you use the Gisbard-Wilson relation, then you realize that if there is u lambda with eigenvalues lambda bar, then there must be also gamma 5 u lambda with eigenvalue lambda star. Okay? So if there is a u lambda, there must be the twin, the twin with the complex, lambda bar complex, and the eigenvector is gamma 5 u lambda. Okay? Now, since the matrix is diagonalizable, then this means that these by orthonormal vector, this means that these two vectors are to be orthonormal. Okay? So this means in particular that u lambda star u lambda, which is nothing else that u lambda gamma 5 u lambda, has to be equal to 0. Okay? So the chirality of these modes here, u lambda gamma 5 u lambda, is equal to 0. Okay? So the spectrum of this operator is so that we can have chiral modes with chirality exactly plus or minus at 0 and in the ultraviolet at 2 over a. And instead we have modes with 0 chirality and they go in doublets, okay? Lambda, lambda star. Okay, now let's use the definition of Q. And we arrive to the result. Now let's look. Now Q was trace, big trace of a bar gamma 5d, okay. And now this quantity here, since the trace of gamma 5 is equal to 0, can also be written like trace of gamma 5 a bar d minus 2. Okay. Because this is equal to this minus 2 gamma 5, but the trace of gamma 5 is 0, so it's okay. Now, this quantity here, okay, first of all, it gets 0 contribution from the complex modes, because when you do the trace here and you expand in eigenmodes, here you will get u lambda gamma 5 u lambda, which is equal to 0, because these modes are chirality 0, okay? So the only contribution that in principle you can get here is from the modes from 0 and 2. But of course, the mod from 0, you don't get any contribution because it's 0, the eigenmod here. And then the only contribution that you get is from lambda bar. Okay? So from here, what you get is 2 times n plus n plus prime minus n prime n prime minus. Okay? These are the ultraviolet modes with chirality plus or minus. Now here, what you get is, okay, again, for chirality, these modes will not contribute. Now the modes, yeah, 2, these times don't contribute because this is 2 over a bar, so 2 minus 2 is equal to 0, while the modes at 0 contribute with minus 2, so it's minus 2 n plus minus n minus, okay? So we can forget the 2, okay? And this is what we get here. Now, if you see how it's done, Q was 2 1/2 of trace of gamma 5 hat, which is 1 minus A bar D, okay? And now you use this relation that I wrote here, and you realize immediately that Q is nothing else than the number of zero modes with chirality plus minus the number of zero modes with chirality minus. Okay? So you see, this is the index theorem, it's called. So you see that Q, if you don't trust what I told you, that if you do the expansion in the classical continuum limit, it's just the topological charge, you see here that Q is nothing else than the difference of the zero modes with chirality plus minus the zero modes with chirality minus. This is exactly the index theorem now on the lattice. Okay? So I hope at the end that I convince you that the, you know, with Gisbard-Wilson fermion, the anomaly here shows up. Anomaly here means the topological charge shows us just when you change the measure, when you make this transformation of variable in your path integral, okay? And this Q is nothing else than the difference of the modes with chirality plus and minus, exactly what you expect in the continuum. Questions? Okay, now... Now the question is, does it exist an operator like this? And this is the best solution and the most used one, is the Neuberger solution operator. This operator is defined like this, is 1 over a bar times 1 plus gamma 5. And now here there is the minus gamma 5 hat. And this is defined as q square root of q square, where Q is nothing else than the Wilson operator, but with a negative mass in units of the lattice spacing, and the negative mass is exactly 1 plus S, okay? We call it the Hermitian Dirac operator, okay, because it's multiplied by gamma 5, and the gamma 5 hermeticity is Hermitian, okay? Anyway, it's essential. Here you can rewrite, forget the gamma 5, and here you can rewrite as without gamma, D Wilson divided D Wilson dagger D Wilson, if you like, okay? And the Neuberger solution, it is just a manipulation of the Dirac operator, okay? But with a big difference, but with a negative mass in its bell, okay? Now, if you look, now, for experts in field theory, they realize immediately that the Wilson operator, as I defined at the beginning, is an ultralocal operator. At most, there is the box inside, so there is derivative 2 in each direction. And that it's a local operator guaranteed, because it's an ultralocal one. Now, here, the inverse of the square root of an ultralocal operator is not guaranteed to be a local operator. And of course, all what I said, including the Luscher symmetry, makes sense only if gamma 5 hat, and only if the Dirac operator and gamma 5 hat, it's local. Because otherwise, we are making non-local transformation in our field theory, which are not very useful. Now, This has been proven by Asenfratz, Jans, the last point, Asenfratz and Luscher. And what you can prove analytically under some conditions and numerically in a more general way is that square root 1 over square root of q square between two points, x and y, norm, okay, this goes like e to the minus c over a x minus y. And you see, so this is not an ultralocal operator, but the important thing here is that when x and y are at the distance x minus y, okay, this operator is exponentially local, okay, with exponential tail which goes to infinity when the lattice spacing goes to zero. Okay, this is important because this means that at finite lattice spacing, the Dirac operator is it's something like this, okay, if these are two lattice spacing. While this operator here is something that is like this, okay, in the distance. But the width of this curve here goes to zero in the continuum limit exponentially, okay. And the fact that it goes to zero and it goes exponentially, it's enough for applying our usual field theory arguments, okay, that are based always on power power counting argumentation, okay. Since this is exponential, it's fine. Okay, so what the solution says is that now we can have this new symmetry here, the Luscher symmetry, and what we paid for this is that it's not exactly like in the continuum to reproduce the anomaly, it has to be the Gisbard-Wilson one, and the operator is not exactly ultra-local, but it's local in a more generalized sense. It's local, exponentially local, like this. Okay. Okay, now, starting with this, now we can go on like we do in the continuum. So then the last part of the lecture is dedicated to build up the word identities that I need tomorrow. Okay, so what we do usually on the lattice, for QCD, we define the left and chiral multiplets, and we do exactly now here with the gamma 5 hat and gamma 5. I'll do first for an f equal 1, one flavor, and then the generalization is trivial. So the projector now on chirality sectors, for the fermions is 1 plus or minus gamma 5 hat divided 2. And y for psi bar, it's 1 half. It's like in the continuum. So this means that I can define right and left with p plus or minus psi. And then I can define psi bar right and left equal psi bar p minus plus. Notice that chiral symmetry for psi bar, you have minus here. It's exchange. Now, the transformation I was showing at the beginning, u left times u1 right, are nothing else that I take now these multiplets and I multiply by independent phases. So psi prime left is the one that we used already in for the measure, but I want to write in a general form so that for n larger than f, we have already the formula. So psi under the left group, we transform like this. And under the right group, okay, this is nothing new, eh? What we have. Now, what you have to be careful is that here, when I write psi left or psi right, there is a p hat here. For instance, just as an example, if you write a bilinear in the continuum, psi where gamma can be gamma phi, gamma mu, and so on, okay? Then, if you want to keep the same chiral content or the same chiral properties of the under that symmetry, under the Luschert symmetry, what you have to define on the lattice is psi bar gamma psi tilde. Okay, where psi tilde now is 1 minus a bar d divided by 2 divided by 2 psi. Okay, try to make as an exercise. If you do the right pseudo-scalar, scalar vector and so on, you will realize that every time you have this in the continuum on the lattice, it's the same form, but you have just to put this term here. Okay, now with all this, we can write now the action for massive fermions, and it's psi bar d psi is the one that we had before. Psi r m dagger psi left plus psi bar left m psi right. Now notice that now, okay, this was the massless action. Now notice that here in the mass part there is a gauge dependence, gauge field dependence, because there is here the projector on the left and right components, and so there is a gauge field dependence. Now under this symmetry here, so this here, this is you can see immediately what we have seen before, that this is invariant. It's invariant under the diagonal axial subgroup of this we saw before, and under the vector group is trivial invariant. Okay. Now what is not invariant here is the mass term, exactly what happened in the continuum. Now if you do this transformation, you will see that that action is not invariant. But we can, okay, so to make it not invariant, but to simplify our life, we can do a so-called spurion transformation. Okay, so we can map the action of the theory with mass m dagger and m with the action to another theory with a different mass. So if at the same time we transform the field psi, and also we transform the mass m dagger in m dagger prime equal vr m dagger v left dagger, and m goes in m prime equal to v left m v right dagger, okay, exactly like you do in the continuum, then if you transform the psi and you transform also the mass, then you will see that the action is invariant. Okay, this doesn't mean that the theory is invariant. When we do this transformation in the path integral, we are mapping a theory with this mm dagger with another theory with m prime and m dagger prime. Okay, so it's not a symmetry of the theory. Now, okay. Now, as I said at the very beginning of yesterday, I said we will keep theta equal zero. So I said this is, you know, the QCDs are a normalizable theory. We have to put all the operator dimension equal less or equal than 4. But I didn't put a theta term there. Okay, and now we will put the theta term just for theoretical usage. So we had yesterday the gluonic action plus the fermionic action, which today is the Gisbert-Wilson one. And then there is another operator that one can put, which is in the Euclidean gets a complex coupling here, times Q, where Q is the topological charge, the integral of the topological charge density. Okay, this is just the integral of FF tilde in the continuum. Okay, it's a dimension 4 operator, is gauge invariant, and so it can be there. And it's useful to define e to the minus the energy, the free energy theta m dagger, which is a function of the parameter which enter there now, and I define it as the integral of this this e to the minus s g minus sf plus I theta q normalized to the path integral without the theta term. Okay, we just define this ratio path integrals. Okay, so this is nothing else that the average value of this quantity here in a theory where the action is defined like gluon plus fermions. Okay. And now, now what we do, we take our transformation V of R and we make an axial transformation in which V, so the axial is defined so that VL dagger is equal to VR and is equal to E to the I epsilon zero axial, where this is exactly the one that I used before. There is no gamma 5 or gamma 5 hat because that is included in the projector here. Okay. Now, if I do that transformation and I decide to use epsilon 0 A equal minus theta over 2, so I do a transformation that I'm allowed to do, but I choose the meter of this chiral change of variable in the particular integral to be related to the theta term in the action. Okay, this is a bit weird, but I do that. So if I do that, then you will realize you and you use all what we have done before. Then what you get is now that the psi bar psi is equal to prime prime is equal to e to the I, well, let's write reverse, e to the minus I theta q d psi bar prime d psi. And then with the Spurian transformation you get m prime is equal to e to the I theta m, and m dagger prime is equal to e to the minus e theta m dagger. Try to make the exercise and you will see that you get this. Therefore here, okay, here what we get is that delta u, the path integral in the numerator, times e to the I theta q. So this theta q is eaten back, is eaten by the transformation in the path integral of the measure. This can be written like integral of the links psi prime e to the minus s gluon minus s fermions. But now in s fermions, I just, there is not anymore, here there is m and m dagger, and now here there is m prime and m prime dagger. So this transformation maps the path the partition function of the two theories with different n m and dagger. Okay, so now we use the definition of the free energy, and at the end what we get is that the free energy with theta m and m dagger equal to the free energy of the theory without the theta term, but with the phase, with the phase that goes in the phase of the mass matrix. Okay. So the chiral anomaly or the chiral transformation relates the free energy of two theories. One has a theta term and mm and dagger, and the other has no theta term, but then we put the phase in the mass matrix of the quarks. Okay, this is what you know very well in the continuum, I mean. And here, you obtain it like just a matrix by doing matrix transformation, essentially. But, okay, there are questions? No, because epsilon zero is a general one. I understand it's weird, I mean, because this could be whatever you like, but I choose exactly to remove that term. I mean, otherwise, if you choose differently, you get here another relation, which here you have a residual, you have theta minus epsilon zero a, let's say, and here you get, instead of theta, you get epsilon zero a. I mean, you get a plethora of relation. I'm just interested in this. I mean, Okay, now when there is when the free energy depends on the parameter in your action, in your theory, only through particular combination, there are world identities. You know it very well. We will see exactly the same things in the last lecture for the energy momentum tensor. Okay, so for the moment, let's use this one. And let's define, so the it's called the topological susceptibility. And it's called chi, and we will use a lot this tomorrow. This is just defined as 1 over the volume, second derivative with respect to theta square of f of theta, okay, mm dagger, at theta equals 0. We will work all, as I said, theta introduced just for a theoretical reasons. And now you can see that this quantity there is equal to a to the fourth on the lattice, sum over x, of q of x, q of 0. Okay, so what is the, this is four dimensional x. So what is chi? Is the correlator of 2 q of x, so 2 trace of gamma 5 dxx in this case, at 2 here x and 0, but integrating over all x. Okay, so this is the sort of things that you don't like very much in field theory, because you are integrating only the point, you are summing here also the point when x is equal to 0. And there are all these short distance singularities that we don't like because are not universal, are not physical, and so on. Okay. Now, now what I did here to define chi is just to use the left-hand side of this formula. So I derived theta. If you remember, theta was here. When you derive 2 times the logarithm of this partition function, you bring down q and q square, and then you normalize. Okay. And that is the the definition. Now we can do the same, but on the right hand side. We derive with respect to theta, but on this right hand side here. And then we put theta equals 0. You see, then when we put theta equals 0, then the 2 theory becomes the same theory. Okay, but we get some interesting relation. So if we do that, f of theta, and then we put theta equals 0, and for simplicity, let's put immediately also m equal m dagger, so there is no parity violation. Okay. Then you can prove, then just do 2 times this derivative, and what you get is minus a to the fourth sum over x of psi left m psi right plus psi right m dagger psi left, plus a to the 8, plus a to the 8, sum over x and y of psi left m psi right minus psi right m dagger psi left. Times in x, times the same in 0. Psi left m psi right minus psi bar right m dagger psi left computed in 0. So just try to do this. You derive, and then what you get, this m equal m dagger, I assume it, but I leave it separate here because of different chiral transformations. And then now what you see here, so let's simplify and write in a human form. So let's say mm dagger is equal m times the identity, okay? Oh, sorry, in this case m, because we are in one flavor theory. So it's just m, small m. Then let's define the scalar density, the usual psi bar psi. Let's define it's with multiplets, it's psi left, psi right, plus psi bar left, psi left. And let's define the pseudo-scalar one as psi left, psi right, minus psi right, psi left. So the P not in, in usual notation is nothing else than psi bar gamma phi psi, okay? Now, if you use this definition, you plug in here and here, what you get at the end is a to the fourth sum over x of q of x, q of 0, is equal to m square a to the fourth sum of x p 0 x p 0 0 minus m the scalar. Okay, okay, this is the basic and fundamental word identity that we will need. This is telling, is an integrated word identity, and is telling that the topological susceptibility, now again, when you derive with respect to theta and you put theta equal to zero, these two free, what you get is something that are in the same theory, okay? And this is telling you, so we pass to a different theory, but and this proves an identity that tells you that the topological susceptibility is equal to the correlation of two pseudoscalar densities, singlet densities, times integrated, minus m times the chiral condensate. Okay? So this is the... Okay, this was the starting point of Witten and Venetian argumentations, which leads to the formula, but this relation... and they made several assumptions to arrive to the formula, okay? Because now, on the, once you are on the lattice, and there is a sentence by Witten that I think is interesting. He said, we can never verify if the formula is right or correct, because we will not never be able to compute this quantity, to define and compute this quantity, okay? And this was before lattice was developed. Now, after so many, now we can test the Witten-Veneziano formula. To do that, it's not enough to have this word identity, because this word identity, it's a word identity among things that are not well defined. Okay, this is divergent when you go to the in the continuum limit, and this is divergent, okay? So, as it is written in the continuum-like form, it's not a useful identity. Let's see why it's divergent. And of course, when you do the real computation, you get immediately that the divergences, okay? So you get something that is useless. For instance, let's suppose to have the topological susceptibility. So in the continuum, you will write it, you would write it chi as integral 4x of q of x q of 0, okay? Let's suppose that you have been able to renormalize this operator correctly and so on. But now, once you integrate the correlator, you have to be careful about the short-distance singularities, okay? What happened when x goes to 0? Now, this is a dimension for operator with parity odd. This is a dimension for operator parity odd. But then this means that q of x, q of 0, when x goes to 0, you expect to go like 1 over x square to the 4th power times the identity, okay? As an operator, let's say, as an operator relation, okay? When you do the OP. Now, if you then this means that when you integrate near 0, this quantity here, this is divergent, okay? So it's not well defined. How this appears on the lattice? Now, if you on the lattice you define q by trivially, what was done in the 90s all the time, if you define it trivially as a coefficient time trace of f mu nu tilde, and for f mu nu you use a naive discretization of f mu nu, so combination of plaquettes essentially. The fact that there is this divergent here appear, then you do the integral, you see d4x divided 1 over x squared to the 4th is a divergent that goes with the 4th power of 1 over modulo of x, okay? This appears with a divergent that goes like with the 4th power of 1 of the lattice space, okay? And so this quantity, if you do, again, the naive definition, it makes no sense, okay? You just compute it and you get garbage out of it, Okay. Now, if you do the same here and here, it's exactly the same problem in each of them. Here is essentially the same argument. Okay. While here, the argument is again. Now, if you compute the chiral condensate S0 in the continuum will be psi bar psi somewhere. Okay. Now, psi bar psi, for instance, in the three-flavor theory, where usually we do, this is, and you use the chiral transformation that I was showing before, this is nothing else we saw here, that psi left, psi right, plus psi right, psi left, okay? So with three-flavor, this is a three-bar under left and right, plus a three-bar three, okay, under chiral transformation. Now this is dimension three operators, so it has non-trivial properties under this symmetry. So this means what you have to do, you have to mix this operator with all lower dimensional operators. Okay, the identity cannot be there because that's not the identity is singlet under chiral symmetry. But you can have m over a square plus times a coefficient plus the same coefficient m dagger over a square plus other terms. Okay. So you see, because M and M dagger, if you see the transformation, transform exactly this way. Okay. So you see that as soon as you are out of the chiral limit, even the condensate is not defined. Okay. So all these three terms here are not defined. So this relation as it is not useful. Okay. So now our goal is to make it useful, to transform it and to make it useful and then compute on the lattice. I mean, and this took almost 10 years to understand how to do that. Okay. Okay, so now the first up to now we were in NF equal 1. Okay, when I derived it. Now we can do exactly what I did so far, but in generic NF. I will need at some point 5, okay, but so we can do psi will be psi 1 psi nf and so on. Psi bar is in a multiplet. And then again, psi prime, I write only some of psi prime gamma 5 up is the same for all the flavors. And for instance, psi left prime will be v left psi left. And the same for the right transformation and the same for psi bar, analogous to one flavor, with the only difference that now the matrix VL is not only an element of U1, but also there is the non-abelian part of the chiral, what I was showing, SU2 left times SU2 right. In this case, it's SUNF left times SUNF right. Okay, and these are just the generator. In this case, this is the parameter for the left group and the generator in flavor transformation. So for these are the Pauli matrices divided by 2 in 2 flavors, the Gell-Mann matrices divided by 2 in 3 flavors, and so on. Okay. Okay, and it is the same for the right transformation. Okay. Okay, and then I define an axial transformation like in the for the singlet case, and the axial transformation is defined so that minus epsilon zero left is equal epsilon zero right, which is equal in my notation epsilon zero axial, and minus epsilon zero left is equal to A right A is equal epsilon zero axial A. Okay. Now you do the mass transform exactly like was showing before, and at the end you get the same relation that we had at the beginning for the one flavor theory, that theta, the free energy m dagger, this is equal to f of zero. Now since you have several nf here, you have to put theta over nf m. E to the minus theta over nf m dagger. Okay, there is a 1 over nf in front. Uh, Now you do exactly the same things. You derive two times with respect to theta, you get the topological susceptibility. You derive two times on this side with respect to theta. You do all the algebra, and then what you get now is exactly exactly this form here, okay? With the following differences. Here you get an nf square in the denominator. Yes. And here you get another nf square in the denominator. Minus m, okay. Yes. Now with the only difference now that the scalar is defined like this, but now these psi are multiplets. Okay, so this is u bar u plus d bar d and so on. And also these ones are multiplet. Okay? So it's u bar gamma 5u and so on. Okay? But you can write like this. Again, if you look at it, this is divergent, this is divergent, this is divergent. So even at this stage it's not interesting. Okay, now we start now to make it interesting. We need to do we start today and then we will finish tomorrow. But we need to make a certain non-singlet. So we have to use not the abelian part of the chiral group, but we have to use the non-abelian part of the chiral group. Okay, so we need to use the word identity which come from the transformation. From the transformation, when I wrote V left, there was the abelian part here. And then there is the ATA. So we need to see how, you know, the theory, the action, the measure, and so on transform under this transformation here. And then we will combine in a judiciously way this transformation with this one, and then we find something that is well defined. Okay. So let's start with V left, dagger. We make an axial transformation. And this is 1 plus I epsilon A A T A plus higher order terms, I don't care. Okay? Now, then you, in the same, okay, then you transform psi bar and psi like we did before. And then what you do, you compute the variation of the action under this transformation, like exactly we did in Flavor theory for the singlet, but this time not for the singlet. And then what you get is the transformation of the action is minus a to the fourth I epsilon a sum over x of psi bar t a gamma 5 d plus d at gamma 5 at psi plus the mass term, the rotation of the mass term. And the rotation of the mass term is psi right anti-commutator of ta m dagger psi left minus a to the fourth e epsilon a sum over x psi left anti-commutator ta m dagger psi right. Okay, so again, as in the singlet case, this is equal to zero thanks to Gisbard-Wilson relation, exact chiral symmetry. While this is not invariant, it's not invariant because if you like, the mass also has to be transformed. Okay. Now we do exactly what we learn at the university. So what we do under this transformation, the measure is invariant. Is invariant because you will get a trace of gamma 5 hat, but within the trace there is also a TA. Okay. And so you will get something that is trace in color, spin and space, of gamma 5 at and TA. And then the trace over color of TA is equal to zero. Okay? So this means that there is no anomaly for this transformation. Okay? So the measure is invariant. And then So this means the following, that we can write the generic expectation value of an operator. We can write like 1 over z, and then here in the measure, instead of putting deep psi bar deep psi, we can put the prime. We chain variable, and since the measure is invariant, we put the prime. Here, the gluon is not affected by this transformation, the gluon action. Then the fermionic action will get minus SF minus delta of SF, because we saw from here that the delta, this is part is invariant, but this is not invariant. So what we are doing here is to write this quantity here times the operator plus delta of the operator. So we are writing, just we take the path integral without the prime, and we make this change of variables, nothing else. Since the action is not invariant, we get delta S of F, and we get also variation of the operator if the operator is not a singlet under that symmetry. And so if we do that way, we get the usual formula that delta S, now this quantity and this quantity has to be equal, because this is just the same path integral written with different variables, okay? So this means, so this quantity can be written like O plus, if we bring down that one, is minus delta SF, the linear term of this, of the variation, plus delta O, okay? Has to be equal to O. Now this cancel, and then this means that now delta SF times a generic operator O has to be equal to the variation of the operator under this symmetry. These are all global symmetries, and there is never. Now we are almost there. Now let's choose as an operator, we choose the pseudoscalar density with a Flavour index B. So this means that this is psi bar left TB psi right minus psi bar right TB psi left. This is just the pseudoscalar density I defined before, but there is a TI, so in the continuum this will be like this. Okay, psi bar gamma 5 TA psi. Okay. So what we have to do now, delta SF we already have, we have to do the variation under this transformation of the operator. What you get there, try to do it, and you see that the variation gets minus E epsilon AA times psi bar left, the commutator of T, anti-commutator of TA TB, psi right, plus psi bar right, the anti-commutator of TATB, psi left. Now let's, for simplifying the notation again, M equal M dagger equal now, all the mass are the same, so this is times the identity. This is the identity in the NF, so it's NF times NF in the Flavour space. If we do that, we use this relation with this and with this variation of the action, you cancel some terms, then you get at the end 2m, the usual PCSC relation integrated, a to the 4 sum over x, p0a x p b0 equal delta ab divided nf for the condensate. Now this is the condensate, is the singlet, s0. So it's the same that appears here, while this is the non-singlet. Here there are TA and TB inside. Okay. Again, on the what I'm writing here on the lattice is all well defined. A fixed lattice spacing is all well defined. Okay, these are just identity. If you compute it, you know, you can, by using the spectral properties of the Dirac operator, you just prove that these are just trivial identities, okay, algebraic identities. The problem is that we would like then to go to the continuum limit for each of these correlators, and this makes no sense in the continuum limit at m equal different from zero, and this makes no sense in the continuum limit for m different from zero, okay? Now we can see Okay, let's say this was the status before all this business started. Okay, this was known, of course, this was known. And now the idea of this business to make the Witten argument rigorous and therefore checkable on the lattice, non-perturbative, is try to combine this worded entity with this and the son or the daughters of this worded entity here, okay, of these two worded entities. So the trick is to use again the non-singlet worded entity in the singlet one and see if we can cook up something that makes sense. Okay, so let's see for the moment, let's see this and this in this term, and okay, in the condensate is the same. Now, when you compute this quantity, and we work always in the degenerate case, always this case here, okay, today and tomorrow always. So when you compute the correlation of a singlet, again, there is the determinant, okay, and then there is the weak contraction of this one. Now, how it's done, the weak contraction? It's done minus nf times this contraction. I will tell you in a minute what it is. This is x and 0 plus nf, and the contraction which is done, the so-called disconnected contraction, okay, in x and 0. Okay, what it is this? So here what we have to do? Here we have to do psi bar I gamma 5. For the moment I do like, okay, psi tilde I in x, and contracted with psi bar j 0 gamma 5 psi tilde j in 0. Okay, sum over I and j. Okay. So you do your path integral, the fermion part, you get the determinant, and that's it from the action. But then here you have to do the weak contraction. So you see, for the weak contraction, you have two kinds of weak contraction. What we call the connected one, in which psi tilde I contracts with the psi j. Okay. And then what you are left with is just to contract psi j with psi I. Okay. And this, so you have nf times this contraction here, okay, so this with this, and then you contract this with this other field here. But then you can have also here a contraction in which I and I contract with itself, okay, and j contracts with itself, okay. Here you have nf times and nf times, okay, and this gives you this contraction here. Now, if we compute this quantity here, what you get is PAX, PA 0, because when A is different from B, it's 0, okay, equal to, and now what you have to do here is the contraction psi bar gamma 5 psi tilde I t I j psi j, and then here you have psi bar kappa t k l gamma 5 psi tilde l, okay. Now here, since the trace of each of these T matrices is 0, the only contraction that you have is when this contracts with this and this contracts on the other side. And what you are left with, there is a minus sign, because the fermion and antifermion has to change. And then there is the trace, what you are left is the trace of TA, TB, times exactly the same contraction that you had here. Okay? Now, this is an half here. And so you see that the contraction that you have here and the contraction that you have here actually are the same. So, and in fact, if you put things together, what you are left with is that these two worded entities leads to a to the fourth sum over x of q of x, q of 0, equal to m square a to the fourth sum of x p I I x p j j x. I will tell in a moment what is, okay, where There is no summation over I, and I is different from J for the two flavor theory, up and down, for instance. Okay. And PII now in X, for instance, is psi flavor I left psi flavor I right minus psi flavor I right psi flavor I left. Okay. So what we have written here, what we are saying here, is that Q bar Q, okay, the insertion of Q bar Q is nothing else that M square, the insertion of two contraction done like this, okay? And so now, you see that we have removed, in the first step, what we have done, we have removed the chiral condensate that was a divergent quantity, okay? And we are left now just with the correlation of two pseudoscalar densities, which is still a divergent quantity. Okay, so we are still not happy. Okay, now tomorrow we will see how this again can be transformed, and we'll arrive to have a quantity on this side which is not anymore divergent. Okay, thank you.